Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. It is Wade T. Leitert from Bioptimizers and another edition of the Awesome Health Show. And today we are going to get into some really, really cool topics about kava. Kava is a very interesting product. And today we have an expert in this. His name is Cameron George, and he owns a company called Tru Kava, or Kava, whatever you want to say that. So he's a researcher, writer, entrepreneur, and of course the founder of the company, but he is striving to set the industry standard for quality, safety, and education around kava, the mass market. He's focused on developing scalable, user-friendly products that deliver the full therapeutic action of the traditional kava drink, which is the only form which has been highly prized in the South Pacific Islands for over 3,000 years. So what's interesting is Cameron has spent many years investigating just about every aspect of kava that he can imagine, and he's collaborated with some of the most prominent experts in the world in the research and historical use. Now, of course, he's got a lot of information here. I just slammed back one of his Tru Kava drinks just a second ago before we started this podcast. And I'm excited to experience both the intellectual experience of this amazing product, as well as the actual physiological simultaneously, because that's how we do things at Bioptimizers. It's not enough to theorize. We need to optimize. Cameron, welcome to the show.
Wade, thanks so much for having me, man. It'll be fun.
So, I love this stuff. I get so excited. I'm jacked up about this. So what the hell is kava? Like there's, and what does it do? Like how did you discover, like, what's the story here? Like, you know, cause it's an interesting thing. There's a lot of people that talk about kava. There's a lot of mysterious stuff, and we hear about this stuff, and then there's a wide variance of products. How does a guy like you living in Arkansas end up really getting into an herb or a nutritional product from the South Pacific Islands? I'm curious.
Yeah. Okay. So I guess a good place to start would be to kind of define what kava is. And then I'll go into sort of how I found it and how I came across it and how it changed my life and those of many people in this space. So kava is a stress-relieving nootropic drink that's prepared from the roots of a small shrub-like plant that grows exclusively in the South Pacific called Piper Methysticum. So the words Piper Methysticum literally mean intoxicating pepper. And, you know, kava is in this sort of like wheelhouse of psychoactive medicinal plants that are kind of, you know, what's at the forefront of this sort of huge, what we call like a plant renaissance that's happening right now. Like, you know, within like, you know, the functional medicine, health and wellness, personal development space, there are a lot of people who are rediscovering plant medicine across the board. So that means everything from the, you know, sort of, you know, biologically optimizing compounds like we would see in adaptogenic herbs, everything from ginseng to reishi mushroom to cordyceps, all these things that we take that sort of optimize our bodies and our immune systems, all the way to the plants that are highly psychoactive that people use in more acutely medicinal circumstances to actually realign human perspective and, you know, sort of like feed us, I guess, you know, psychologically, mentally, and spiritually as well. And those would be things like the psychedelic class of compounds, like psilocybin mushrooms, and people are going on ayahuasca retreats, and obviously cannabis, whether it be used medically or whether it be used recreationally, now that we've got laws opening up and things like that. Kava is in a very, very unique part of that spectrum. It almost, you know, has, you know, a set of characteristics that are like none other, because it has... It both falls into the semi sort of tonic application part of that spectrum, but also has a lot of the psychological and entheogenic effects. Entheogen meaning, you know, sort of all the psychological effects. The word entheogen means the divine within, and that's really what we get from a lot of these psychedelic medicines. They help with just, you know, introspection and creative thinking, and they help for people to sort of dissect sort of the underpinning parts of their psyche and sort of, you know, put everything out on the table objectively and examine, you know, different aspects of their life from an objective manner, you know? So that's why they're used for self-improvement, and they're good for people sort of visiting some of their traumas and relating to them in different ways and in a more positive manner and such. But, you know, kava falls in this really, really unique place because unlike, say, like some of the really powerful psychedelic compounds that are, that have tremendous medicinal application, but are not tonic herbs. Like, these are not things that you take every single day. These are not things that are even legal in the United States yet. A lot of times you have to go to, you know, you have to go to South America or Mexico or something to have like an ayahuasca ceremony. Or obviously, you know, we're starting to see some, you know, some clinical trials more with psilocybin and LSD and some of these things. You know, but those things are things that have to be used with extreme caution because there's tremendous application to them, but they, you know, they do carry some level of potential danger because, you know, you're going into a really, really profound altered state, right? You know, kava is able to deliver some of those psychological effects without the altered state, without the, you know, profound altered state. So it more, you know, delivers an enhanced state of natural sobriety that makes you more introspective and opens up some of those, you know, sort of perceptual doorways and allows you to, you know, connect, you know, and communicate with people more efficiently and effectively. Helps to, you know, increase the flow of communication across the two hemispheres of the brain, both the creative and the rational side, which is really, really good from a nootropic aspect, you know, introspective, creative thinking, all that kind of stuff. So it definitely falls into that wheelhouse that it's not even near as psychoactive as cannabis. In fact, you maintain your sobriety, but yet it can really, really boost, uplift your mood, make you focused, make you more engaged, but also relax you at the same time. Kava is probably most famous for its relaxing effects because it has effects on the brain that are very similar to alcohol and benzodiazepines at the same time as giving you some of the sort of higher brain function effects, where it's able to bring down the emotional system, the reactive system that drives stress in our bodies by binding to this specific set of receptors in the brain called the GABA receptors. And it does it in a very balanced sort of modulatory way. So it doesn't downregulate them or deplete them like, say, a synthetic drug would. So it actually, the studies that we have now show that kava actually has a good rehabilitative effect on that system. It helps to strengthen and rehabilitate the parasympathetic nervous system that's been beat down over a year's time by too much stress, too much trauma. We actually see an increase in GABA receptor density with long-term use of good, well-sourced kava products. So, you know, all that being said,
that's an incredible statement. So are you actually seeing an upregulation of the receptors?
Yes.
So the only product I know like that is nicotine that will actually increase receptors. So kava does as well.
Yes. Yeah. So this is something that's always been looked at and theorized by indigenous peoples in the South Pacific, but they don't use the same terminology from a scientific standpoint. They use, you know, sort of more direct experiential, like it sort of heals the body's, you know, what we would call the parasympathetic nervous system, but it rehabilitates the psyche and it's medicine for the psyche. And, you know, these are things that they would, you know, say, but, you know, in the last, you know, 30, 40, 50 years, kava's been like pretty rigorously subjected to the scientific lens as well. And it's one of the most well-studied herbs in the world outside of cannabis and ginseng and a couple others. And what we see now in studies is we see an increase in GABA receptor density, and that it needs to be vetted out more. I mean, the research is just piling up, you know, and it has been, it's accelerating over the last few years. But, and it was something that I've experienced personally as well. And I work with a network of several hundred functional medicine doctors that we've used, you know, we've integrated it into these physicians' practices, and it's been used very successfully to get a lot of people off of addictive benzodiazepine drugs, which, you know, benzodiazepine addiction is an epidemic in this country. And now that we have a huge underpinning of stress and trauma, especially going into 2020, it was already there before, but it's going to be more of a relevant epidemic than we even well, than we even knew about before, obviously.
Dr. Jordan Peterson, the famous psychologist out of Toronto, who kind of came to fame, as was interesting the word turned words, came to fame a number of years ago, actually fell prey to benzodiazepine addiction. They had been treating it, and he had a fit. And what people don't understand, this is not a mental addiction. This is a serious physiological division. And he ended up, to get off it, he almost lost his life. They put him in a medically induced coma in Russia for like 10 days for him to come out. Yeah. It was a very horrific thing. Like, once you're addicted to these things, coming off them is a very serious, like, it's not like most people in the West don't even know how to do it. So we need to avoid getting in that rabbit hole. And they're very highly prescribed medications. Am I right?
Yes. There's some of the most widely prescribed medications in the world, and it's becoming more and more of an issue now that, you know, we're seeing this profound explosion in chronic degenerative diseases, of which stress is always the main contributing factor. So benzos are just sort of readily prescribed for a lot of things. And even, you know, any savvy, you know, sort of mainstream psychiatrist that, you know, a lot of their belief system lies, you know, totally on medicines, they're still very scared of these drugs, but they prescribe them because people are in such egregious circumstances, both with seizures and, you know, sleep disorders, severe anxiety and everything. But yes, like what happened to Jordan was he just got on a very, very small dose of benzodiazepine. I think I heard his daughter Michaela talking about it. She was talking, he started on like half of a milligram, which is a very small dose. And it wasn't even doing a whole lot for him. He wasn't even noticing even like the beneficial effects. And he just continued to take it. And he got to a period of time where it lost its effectiveness totally. He tried to go off it, and he went into a severe sporadic withdrawal that ended up in seizures and all kinds of stuff. And benzodiazepine withdrawal is one of the most dangerous and, you know, horrific medical situations that a person can go through. It's worse in so many ways than opiate withdrawal. Opiate withdrawal and benzodiazepine withdrawal and alcohol withdrawal are the three that can kill you.
Correct.
Other withdrawals are horrible, but, you know, benzos and alcohol are the most dangerous because, I mean, they're potentially lethal. And if it's not lethal, it's complete hell. I mean, so if you're anywhere on that spectrum, even if you're not on the severe end, you know, if your chemistry is not super fragile going into the usage and, you know, into the addiction, even if you have a rock solid nervous system, like, no one gets out of like long-term benzo use unscathed, you know, essentially. I mean, it's very, very rare that someone just easily gets off of them, because it's just that GABA system is such a pivotal system in the body for the regulation and the modulation of the balance between GABA, the most inhibitory neurotransmitter, which is like the brakes of the nervous system, and glutamate, which is the most excitatory neurotransmitter. It's very, very crucial, but it's very highly regulated and modulated. If it gets out of balance, it burns out the system. It starts to, you know, that's what leads to, you know, excitotoxicity, seizures, and things like that. You know, in fact, you know, the food additive monosodium glutamate is directly toxic because it's a form of glutamate that elates the system and gives, you know, you this huge boost in mood and makes you feel good, and which is why it's very addictive, but it burns out the motor neurons at the same time. And it's a neurotoxic substance. So when you throw off that system, you end up, you know, the system sort of ricochets in the opposite direction. When you deplete GABA and glutamate, it goes crazy. And then it ends this inflammatory cascade that's very, very dangerous. So It's a really, really egregious, you know, situation in the world right now, both with people with chronic anxiety, sleeplessness, and the imbalance between this parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system. And the indigenous people of the South Pacific, when it comes to, you know, medicine like kava, I mean, they never saw it, you know, that much for this application, because they weren't suffering from the same diseases we're suffering from today. But they saw it as a you know, a substance that they could use to relax, to connect, to get into these sort of introspective states where, you know, where empathy is increased, where focus is increased, and they could connect to one another in a much, much deeper way and sort of reflect on their internal circumstances in their life. So it has so many of these different, you know, sort of actions, right, in the body and in the mind that are amazing. In fact, in the South Pacific, it's been traditionally used for almost every social context imaginable. So weddings, funerals, spiritual ceremonies, social gatherings. It is a foundational part of the social framework of these islands, right? It's the number one export in an island chain called Vanuatu, which is really the home of kava, where it was first used over 3,000 years ago. And then in Fiji as well, too. It's just such a sacred substance to these people. Even though they have access, like, it's, you know, say in Vanuatu, to more powerful, you know, psychoactive compounds like psilocybin mushrooms, they see kava as their most sacred substance, because sometimes it's not the stronger the better. Sometimes less is more. And sometimes something that you can take regularly over a long period of time that continuously has cumulative benefits on the psyche subtly that you can sustain is actually going to be the best medicine in some circumstances, because it can be well tolerated by the greatest amount of people over the longest period of time. And it doesn't, you know, it's like if stronger psychedelics will shout a message at you, kava kind of whispers it, but it, you know, it's very subtle. So it has that psychological aspect to it, but then it also has this amazing physiological aspect that now we have this whole new set of applications for it in the West and in the modern world, where we have this explosion of chronic disease that's, you know, highly contributed to by stress, where we have these upsets and these, you know, destructions of the nervous system that are relatively new because of our philosophy of, you know, better living through chemistry and better living through technology and stuff, in which we're trying to come to complete terms with and, you know, try to realign ourselves with nature while embracing technology at the same time. And so I'm sure a lot of your listeners understand about a lot of the environmental circumstances that, you know, cause a lot of this chronic disease. But me, you know, discovering kava and coming across it was a life-changing event for me, because me being in the middle of a severe autoimmune disease at the time and having seizures 10 times a day and such, this medicine, as where I had, you know, many prior experiences with other plant medicines, psychedelic medicines and cannabis, kava was really one of those that just completely changed my life. And I realized that it virtually didn't have a place currently in the modern world and in the modern market in its true form, because there's so many ways you can screw up kava, and the kava that is out there actually is not by definition considered kava at all and doesn't carry most of these effects, carries a very small shade of them. So
we'll go back to that in a minute. I want to, mm-hmm. you just touched on something. You just snuck in like a nuclear bomb there, which is that you were had this, you know, these severe physiological symptoms. Can you share with our listeners what was going on for you that put you on this journey to find this out, and obviously found some corrective benefits? Can you share that with us?
Yeah, exactly. I guess just to kind of start from the base of my story, I guess, you know, so many of us who get into this world, we both come across a lot of, you know, different influencers and amazing people and entrepreneurs and, you know, this whole sort of health and wellness, personal development space that spans all the way from, you know, your guys, like, you know, we both know, like Dave Asprey, all the way to guys like Jordan Peterson, you know, that you touched on there. You know, a lot of people who make it into this world, you know, a lot of their experiences come out of their own pain, right? It's like, I didn't, you know, wake up one day at 21 years old or 25 years old and say, hey, I'm going to go and I'm going to explore, root-like muddy drinks that are drank in islands in the South Pacific by indigenous people in a village, right? It's like, that's not something that would have come across my psyche had I not been pressured to a point that, you know, forced me into a huge sort of odyssey investigatory process over, you know, a decade's time that sort of led me to some of these things. But when I was pretty young, I started to get pretty sick, like so many people today. I developed a pretty severe neurotoxic autoimmune spectrum illness, which, you know, you know, basically, you know, for people to understand, you know, to kind of understand what that means is, I just had a, you know, pretty much a complete collapse of my health that I later realized all came from an autoimmune process in my body that was contributed to not by one thing. It wasn't like one thing that made me sick. It was a combination or an accumulation of a bunch of different cumulative factors that overwhelmed and overburdened my system and got me to start expressing a lot of the symptoms of my genetic weaknesses, right? Through, you know, an epigenetic process. You know, I always use, in our sort of world, the functional medicine world, we've got a metaphor that we always use for this of why some people get sick and why some people don't. And, you know, we call it the bucket metaphor. You know, everybody has a metaphorical stress bucket, right? And every stressor, both physical, chemical, emotional, spiritual, is a drop in the bucket. Some people have smaller buckets than others. And, you know, the minute that your bucket starts to overflow, then you start, expressing the symptoms of your genetic weakness, whether it be ulcerative colitis or whether it be, you know, MS or whether it be Crohn's or whether it be lupus or whether it be Hashimoto's or any of these things. But, you know, whenever, you know, I think about autoimmune disease, most of the chronic diseases today are autoimmune in their components, whether it be Alzheimer's, type 2 diabetes, obesity. And that comes from chronic inflammation, which we all, you know, kind of know is the underpinning of this. But when I think about chronic inflammation, I really think about chronic irritation, right? Irritation, meaning that the stress bucket gets full. The immune system, which is the interface between you and the outside world that deals with incoming stressors of all kinds, physical, chemical, or emotional, it gets primed. You know, imagine if someone comes up to you and slaps you in the face once, you know, it kind of gets your attention. They slap you in the face twice, you're on edge more. You slap you in the face again, you're ready to fight. You know what I mean? So that's what happens to the immune system over time, is it starts to become hostile and it starts to become highly reactive and it gets primed. And then it gets to a point where it starts to chronically pour out inflammation and start to fight, you know, a pathogen or an invader that's not even there because it's been traumatized so much. The bucket has been full for so long that the immune system is self-creating an inflammatory storm, just like an army, right? You've sounded the alarm and, you know, you start to throw off all these missiles and eventually you get friendly fire and you're devastating the whole system with an inflammatory storm. That can cause a loss of health. And how that manifests from person to person is just, you know, depends on your genetic susceptibilities. Remember, you know, genes don't, you know, for the most part, cause 98% of disease, but they are the loaded gun and the environment will pull the trigger. So you can have a susceptibility to these certain things. So I had, you know, different susceptibilities to different types of neurological dysfunctions, and that inflammation affected me neurologically first, and my gut and a few different other things. But eventually the whole system broke down. And the reason why I didn't, you know, come right out of the gate and say I was just diagnosed with I had Crohn's or I had this or I had that, because I got diagnosed with like 20 different things. I had a complete collapse of my health, where at one point I was diagnosed with Crohn's, I was diagnosed with Hashimoto's, I was diagnosed with MS, I was diagnosed with a lot of different diseases. At the end of the day, these labels are really just, well, you know, these names are just labels that we put on symptom clusters, but really what I'm interested in is the pathology. What is the disease process that's causing it? And more importantly, what are all the drops in the bucket that are causing the bucket to overflow to start this process, right? So for me, I was about 21 when all of this stuff came to a head. I had been experiencing some dysfunction for a while, but during my adolescence, I was still very high functioning. I was a competitive distance runner. I ran it in college, and you know, whenever my health broke down, I was actually in the midst of, you know, I qualified for the Olympic trials and in the marathon. I was a very high functioning person. I was working 3 jobs, you know, in school, all that stuff. But I started to become a little bit fatigued and having some neurological stuff, some attention stuff, some anxiety stuff. And I just thought, hey, you know, I'm overtraining, I'm overworked, I'm overburdened. So I started to back off. Didn't get better. Actually, it got worse. Within, you know, a couple few months, I was profoundly fatigued. You know, I was on the couch, couldn't get off the couch. I was extremely depressed. I didn't know what was wrong. I just thought it was a moral failing. I thought that I needed to push the accelerator harder, and I was pushing it and the wheels were just continuing to spin. And I just continued to deteriorate more and more and more and more. And I'm thinking, what the heck is going on here? You know, I mean, I was functioning well. I had a lot of issues that I wasn't really aware of. I had normalized them. But then when the bottom really fell out, it fell out. And, you know, here I am, you know, 22 years old, and I have this huge just breakdown because, you know, psychologically, that's hard for a person that age, especially when you're an athlete and you're used to functioning all this stuff, where it's like you just feel like you're weak. And it's like, what the heck is wrong with me? And at this time, you know, again, I mean, you know, this was, you know, 10, 15 years ago. And on top of that, I'm from a part of the country that's not in the more, I guess, evolved, you know, part of the country when it comes to alternative medicine, some things. Right. So it was basically just go to a doctor. They type in your symptoms into a computer. It correlates to a medication. Outside of that, they say, well, if you're not dying, then you're well, right? Idea that if I can't see that you're dying right now on a CT scan or this or that, or you have cancer or something, then, you know, then it's just a moral failure.
It's a disease definition or model of health.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Where health is the absence of a diagnosable disease by the technology we have available and the capacity of the physician that you happen to run into.
Yeah. Yeah.
Pretty narrow.
And there wasn't this, and of course, right, the allopathic system is not as much of a healthcare system as it is a disease symptom management program. Where they're just correlating, you know, your different symptoms to a disease process and then giving the corresponding drug and such, which is what eventually ended up happening to me. I kept getting worse and worse and worse, and I got more and more desperate. And although I wasn't someone who wanted to just go after and, you know, take a medication, I ended up in a psychiatrist's office, and I did the worst thing that I could have possibly done at that point, was go on a whole host of different psychiatric drug medications, the primary one being Adderall, which is an amphetamine drug, right? We, you know, most of us know about Adderall, especially, you know, people who have been in the, you know, any industry where there's a lot of people trying to perform and take some of these shortcuts to turn their brains on. A lot of us, you know, whenever we're younger, especially on college campuses, you know, there's an epidemic of just people going and taking these things to cram. I mean, it's an amphetamine, so it overrides and turns on your sympathetic nervous system in a very unnatural way. It's an override of the system. It's a little bit like pouring jet fuel in your car engine. And, you know, unfortunately, when we talk about synthetic pharmaceutical drugs, they're single compounds with a very linear mechanism that's just an override, right? If you think about all the different biochemical processes in your body, it's like an assembly line that everybody's on the same page. You know, the pharmaceutical drug like interrupts the assembly line downstream, down like, you know, four steps down the road, and it creates a quick shift, but it can throw off everything else around it, right? So it's optimizing for certain metrics at the cost of others downstream. So with pharmaceutical drugs, you're not creating any more of these chemicals that you're low on or that you're lacking. Like say with Adderall, it'd be like dopamine, right? You get this huge dopamine boost, but you're not giving yourself more dopamine. You're just using up your body's energy stores, and you're just you're borrowing from tomorrow's allowance to pay for today. Eventually you end up in debt with your body, and you can end up in a serious situation. So if you're like me, who was already down this process and I had every sign and symptom of severe metabolic and mitochondrial dysfunction, like I had a severe energy deficit. That's why I was crashed on the couch. I had accumulated a lot of different toxic stress and autoimmunity and such. The worst thing I could have done was put an amphetamine in my system to override it, which is exactly what I did. And I went from being what I thought was in a bad situation to I got on the drugs, and like you would expect, I felt better the next day. So I think, oh, this is the answer, blah, blah, blah. I go on it for 2 years. Within that 2 years, my life deteriorated in ways that I can't even describe in a short conversation. I mean, it deteriorated and obliterated what was left of my life at that point. Within 2 months of getting on Adderall, I went into, you know, what I can only describe as a full-blown sort of like amphetamine psychosis, where it totally changed my personality. And I started living the life of a meth addict. And at this time going up until now, I was a very functional, responsible person. And I got on this drug and, you know, a few other drugs and that, but that was the main one. And within months, my entire life externally changed. I started connecting with people who are on that same wavelength, like drug addicts and stuff. It led to me taking other stuff. I ended up being, you know, going on a crazy manic, hyper impulsive, like buying spree and charging up hundreds of thousands of dollars of credit. I ended up in an apartment. I was in college at the time. I ended up with an apartment full of exotic animals that I just went and purchased at different places. I had like monkeys and dogs and parrots. And like, this was like a complete disaster, right? It's like things were normal. I go down this road of synthetic drugs, these pharma drugs. I already had problems. So I didn't go upstream and look for the cause. I tried to medicate downstream and I gave up responsibility, my health, and I put it in the hands of a physician who had a certain philosophy of using these drugs, obviously. And my life deteriorated so much, both financially, physically, psychologically, and it just invited a whole host of different toxic circumstances that just destroyed everything, right? I ended up in so much debt. After about a year and a half, the drugs lost their effectiveness. And I thought that I was fatigued before. Like, I had to go off of them because they just made me completely crazy. And I had interventions for my family that were done to me and, the whole lot. And I went off of them and, fatigue and brain fog don't even begin to describe it. Like, what I had before was fatigue and brain fog. This was like brain dead and like literally can't get off the couch. And I'm having severe cognitive deficits, like, wow. Pretty severe that were getting worse as time went on. So whenever I got off Adderall and all of these drugs, I had, my brain felt like it was like completely fried. And it was deteriorating rapidly after that too. Like, I got to a point where I had to stop driving. I had to move back in with my parents at the time. I ended up pretty much completely incapacitated. I had such bad cognitive deficits that I was starting to not recognize people in my own family. I couldn't leave the house without getting lost or going down. And this is like not a normal scenario. This is like a severe, sort of neurotoxic reaction to these drugs. It was just a perfect storm. I had all the susceptibility, all these factors come in, and then this whole thing just sort of hit me. So anyways, my health just continued to deteriorate because I had, was on the aftermath of all this damage. It just had sped up the progression of this process. And, basically I started deteriorating pretty rapidly, ended up having a bunch of environmental sensitivities after that, which is something that happens whenever your bucket gets full. They call it multiple chemical sensitivity, but it's something that a lot of neurotoxic people experience, especially in today's world where it's becoming an epidemic, where these very neurotoxic autoimmune cases, people develop all these sensitivities to things in their environment. Mine were severe. I started reacting at one point, months down the line after getting off Adderall, I started reacting to almost every food I was eating, every supplement I was taking. I was reacting to lights and sounds, and it's a form of PTSD basically. But I was reacting so bad that I got to a point where every bite of food that I was taking would send me into a full grandma seizure. Jeez. And so I ended up at this medical research facility in Dallas, Texas. That's basically like a community for very severe the most severe autoimmune, sort of environmental sensitivity cases that you have ever seen, right? Where they quarantine people. It's like, that was a new word for me at the time. Like, I was quarantining before it was cool. And
I never knew it was cool, but
yeah, exactly. or as people would say, it was
cool. Common, but quarantine before it was common.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Before it was a thing. But so I was down at this medical research facility where, I thought my life was over because on paper, I just had, it just didn't seem, it seemed completely insurmountable because I was doing nothing but deteriorating. I was losing the ability to eat. I lost, 40, 50, 60 pounds at one point. I was dwindled down to nothing. And I was having these constant seizures that it got to a point where they became pseudo lethal, right? Like, where's a very dangerous situation where I was so weak. And these seizures, I got to a point where having another one could have killed me. So obviously, it was a really egregious situation because of my reactions. I was reacting to everything I was taking or doing. So I couldn't even take anti-seizure drugs or meds because I would react more to them and they would cause seizures instead of, it was an insane situation. I would have never even thought this was possible. At one point, I even started reacting to water, which I never would have thought was possible. But I got to a point where I could not drink water, whether it be the mineral content. I was so reactive that I put water on my tongue and I would go into a seizure. And it was like clockwork. And it was so crazy that I ended up, there was one point where I ended up going weeks without food, which was like an extended fast, was actually some healing that occurred there, believe it or not. But I actually had to go days without water, and I almost died from kidney failure and dehydration whenever I was there in Dallas, Texas. So all of this happened and I deteriorated to a point. Through this whole period of time, from the time I got off the drugs to the time that I was at my absolute worst and almost, you know, near death, I spent, that was actually like about a you know, 6 or 7 year period, actually. That was, it sounded like it was a, you know, short thing, but it was actually like a long period of time where I was completely, you know, you're basically disabled. I did nothing throughout that 6 or 7 years, but scour medical and scientific literature, articles, research. I was traveling around with my family. I couldn't travel around by myself, obviously. And I was talking, making contact with doctors and researchers and scientists, because I am definitely someone who will dig, as I would scour the earth for an answer, right? And I had made a decision that I was going to fight. I was going to fight. I was going to spend every last bit of energy that I had in my body to just try to find any semblance of information that would lead to an answer. It was about the time that it was at my worst that I got in contact with a functional medicine doctor who was leading, you know, a network of functional medicine doctors around the country. His name was Dr. Dan Pompa, and he's a, you know, sort of a cellular detox sort of specialty expert, where they develop and teach protocols for a process that we call Tru Cellular Detox, which is basically just a very comprehensive detoxification program that uses targeted supplements, various treatments, therapies, modalities, fasting, intermittent fasting, ketosis, diet variation, all of these things in systems to try to inch someone back to better metabolic health and to bring down the toxic concentrations in their tissues, right? So for neurotoxic conditions. So I got in contact with them, and when I was at my very, very worst, I was able to get enough of a heavy anti-seizure drug in my system to get me drinking water again, to kind of save my life, but I was nowhere near out of the woods. Started working with, you know, this doctor and a couple, you know, different other people, and we slowly sort of started to get some inertia going. But during my process, I got to a point where I knew I couldn't keep taking these drugs, because one of the drugs was a heavy benzo. So I was heavily addicted to Klonopin. I was on a huge dose of Klonopin. I'd already been down this road with Adderall. I knew that it was going to lose its effectiveness, and then I was going to ricochet in the other direction, like we talked about earlier. And I was not, my body would have, it was, there's no way I would have survived it. I knew I could not be without nothing because of my reactions at that point, because my reactions were keeping me from taking, from doing any supplements, any nutrition, anything. But I needed to get off the benzo. So I was in a very serious situation where I needed to find a plant-based, non-addictive analog or a replacement to a benzodiazepine. And I needed to find it pretty darn quick. Good thing I'd already spent years scouring, you know, the ethnopharmacological data for all, you know, different plant compounds, and got into that because I had experiences with psychedelics in the past that just like intrigued me and gave me sort of this fascination with the plant and fungal kingdom and the intelligence that's there and what it offers. And that was really what gave me the means and the inspiration to even fight my process anyways. Thank God I had had those experiences. Psilocybin was one of them. It was actually a psilocybin experience that inspired me to get off of Adderall and to stop that. But anyways, you know, going back to this, I needed to find an answer very, very quickly. And immediately my mind goes to, okay, so I'm speaking with, this doctor that I'm working with and such, and we're trying to find answers. And I'm saying, okay, I need to find, you know, something that binds to the same receptors as a benzodiazepine and offers a level of therapeutic application that is comparable or greater than what I'm experiencing with the benzo. And I didn't know if that existed, honestly. I'm like, dude, I don't know. Because a lot of times with, you know, with pharmaceutical drugs, you know, a lot of these plant compounds are really subtle compared to the pharmaceutical drugs. So you just don't know if something is actually going to work and what level it's going to work at, if it does. You know, the doctor I was working with was offering a lot of great information, great therapies and modalities and strategies, nutritional strategies and everything like that. But in order to tolerate them, I had to find some way to keep my seizures and my nervous system under control and to be able to safely transition off the benzo. So I needed to find, in my mind, I knew this, I needed to find a non-addictive, safe, plant-based or fungal-based analog to this synthetic benzodiazepine. I needed to find something out of the plant or fungal kingdom that was modulatory, that was more biologically compatible, you know, with the nervous system, that wouldn't lead to this, you know, toxicity, dependence, and withdrawal process. So I needed to look at compounds that bound to the same receptors, which is these GABA-A receptors, which is what the benzodiazepines bind to again, but that wouldn't downregulate or deplete them in the same way. And honestly, I didn't know if I was going to find that because you know, a lot of these compounds that we find in the plant kingdom are very subtle, you know, the ones that you take on a regular basis. You know, a lot of these plants, like in this wheelhouse of things that affect the GABA system, things like passion flower and lemon balm and valerian root and skull cap and all of these things, there's nothing wrong with any of them. They're all good. But at that point, it's like I had tried all those things.
And now for a Bioptimizers fixed digestion tip, supercharge your protein shake. Everyone knows protein shakes are a great way to sneak in extra protein, build more muscle, even replace meals and burn more fat. The problem is the highest quality protein typically absorbs at around 40%. One way to fix this and dramatically increase how quickly and effective your protein shake digests is to add 2 to 3 capsules of Masszymes into your shake. One research study showed that pre-digested protein during a meal increased muscle growth significantly. To take advantage of this, just blend the open capsules into your shake, and within 15 minutes or less, the enzymes will have begun to break down the protein into amino acids. This can make your shakes at least 2 to 3 times more potent. Some people do this and sip on their shake while lifting to provide their muscles with a steady stream of amino acids during their workout. To save 10% on Masszymes, use the code SHAKE10, that's SHAKE10, at masszymes.com. That's SHAKE10 at masszymes.com.
That was a little bit like shooting a BB gun at an elephant, right? I mean, it was just not anywhere near enough for what I needed. I had tried medical cannabis. I liked medical cannabis, but at that time, it doesn't work on that system. It doesn't work on the GABA system, especially directly. And it actually made my reactions worse, and it made me more, you know, sort of paranoid and anxious. And THC has this bidirectional effect where it can work or it doesn't, but it certainly didn't work as directly for these purposes. It had all these side effects. I was stoned, the altered state, the whole thing that I didn't want or need at the time. And it just didn't work. So that, you know, cannabis was the go-to, like, strong, you know, drug alternative plant, you know, medicine. And that wasn't the thing. So this led me back around to kava. I had tried kava before. And of course I had read about kava. I read a bunch about kava. When I had tried basically every other supplement over those like 7 years, I had experimented with virtually anything that you could buy at the health food store. And I came, back across it in the literature, you know, because it's sort of in this wheelhouse of GABA receptor binding plant compounds. And, it's like considered to be the all-star. It's considered to be nature's most powerful anxiolytic. But whenever I circle back around to it, I'm thinking, I've tried kava before. It really wasn't any stronger than a cup of chamomile tea. I mean, it was something, but it wasn't anything to write home about and all this stuff. And I had read about, you know, side effects and all this kind of stuff. But I started getting in contact with some people, some friends that I had made in the ethnobotanical community and some researchers and stuff, when I was trying to find an answer here. And I came across this guy who I later became really good friends with, and he was from the South Pacific Islands. And he said, "Have you tried kava?" I said, "Yes, I've tried kava, but you know, it doesn't work," and blah, 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 blah. And he said, "Okay, what'd you try?" And I said, "Well, I went to the health food store. I got this company, and it, you know, came in these little capsules." And he said, "Okay, that's not kava." That's a kava-like product, right? Kava is the drink that's prepared, the full spectrum drink that's prepared from the roots of this shrub, Piper Methysticum. I said, okay, well, I've never tried kava then. And I started reading about it because, and that made sense to me because I had read so much, right? You know, a lot of my, I'd initially read actually this book behind me that I have back here, which is Christian Rash's Encyclopedia of Psychoactive Plants. It virtually is like a, it's encyclopedia of virtually every psychoactive plant that we have in our, in the ethnobotanical sort of pharmacopoeia. And I had read a huge section of kava and I had read, you know, two or three books on it. And I had seen that it was written about as this sort of sacred substance in the islands, and, you know, to a level at which only rivaled that of what some, you know, indigenous populations had referred to like psilocybin as. And I knew how powerful psilocybin was, but then I kind of, in my mind, I was like, well, why is kava so highly prized? I mean, it was nothing special at all whenever I tried it. So whenever I came across this guy in my desperate state and he was telling me that, I was like, that, okay, yeah, I obviously preparation and sourcing matters tremendously. It does with every plant, but with some plants, it really matters. So what he explained to me was that, you know, kava, in order for its full essence, the full sort of effects profile of the plant to actually be present in the final product or whatever you consume, it really heavily relies on the entourage effect. What we talk about, you know, in sort of plant medicine circles and what we hear talked about a lot, like in hemp and cannabis and CBD now, is this understanding that the effects of a plant medicine are different than a pharmaceutical. A pharmaceutical is one molecule. It's one compound that has a very linear mechanism, right? So we kind of talked about before, it pushes the body in one direction or another. There's not much intelligence there because usually pharmaceuticals are made by taking one compound out of a plant somewhere, isolating it, concentrating it, synthesizing it, and into, you know, something that gives you a very direct linear action. That is a hack that's the override to the body that throws off the whole assembly line in the body of chemical processes like we talked about. That leads to the whole thing becoming confused and compensating and downregulating receptors and all this stuff. And that's what leads to the, you know, to the dependency, the addiction, the side effects, all of that. Plant medicines like kava, like cannabis, have a host of hundreds of different biologically active compounds. A plant medicine is a living system, like a human body is a living system that has a multitude of therapeutic compounds and constituents that all work synergistically like the instruments in a musical orchestra, right? And, you know, obviously you can take out one single compound and still get a fraction of the effects. You can take out one instrument in the orchestra, and you can even take out one of the main instruments, like say with cannabis, you could isolate THC and you could see, have that main instrument. It could play the melody and it could give you the main like version of the song. But if you put it in the orchestra, it gives you a whole depth to the experience that far surpasses what you would have just from a single compound. And with plant medicines, that means that you're taking a living system. It interfaces with you as a living system. Because we have to realize, too, that we all are extensions of the natural ecology of the planet, which is an integrated, intelligent system. So we don't like reign over it. We're not these separate things. We're part of a living system, and so are the plants. So whenever we have this other organism, we take that into our body, those systems are compatible because they come from the same sort of creation framework. The same intelligence that developed us as a living system develops the plants. And so those systems interface together and you take it in there, right? And so that's what we call biological compatibility. There's this sync or this synchronization that happens, right? And so with kava, that is incredibly important because the moment that you integrate a preparation method that isolates a few of the active constituents and leaves the others, it dilutes the effects down to a very small fraction of what you would normally get. Because all those instruments work together, those compounds work together to give you this huge experience, right? So that's basically what most kava on the market actually is. 99% of kava on the market is all done with solvent extractions. The indigenous people knew this a long time ago. They've never used solvents to extract their kava because you use a solvent like, you know, one of these high, you know, hydrocarbon solvents or, you know, butane or hexane or one of these things. That can, you know, put toxins in it and everything. Obviously, you can have the solvent left over in there and it'll grab a few constituents and leave others. But even, you know, using alcohol, which is the solvent of choice by most people, It gives you something, but it just grabs a few of the active constituents we call kava lactones. Like in cannabis, they're cannabinoids. These are kava lactones. But it grabs a few of the main ones, which is what a lot of people look for in their testing, but it leaves everything else. And you end up with this thing that's just like, it's a small fraction or a small shade. So the indigenous people prepare kava by taking the ground root, preferably dried in a specific way. So you leave a lot of the bioactive enzymes in place, and you prepare it by squeezing it through a strainer bag into a bowl of warm water. Certain amount of pressure is given. So it's pressure and it's a certain amount or a certain type of heat. And this brings out the full spectrum of active constituents that are like a suspension into the liquid. The kava lactones are oil-like compounds. They're lipids. And then there's all these other different flavonoids and enzymes and other things that activate the lactones and bring them into the cells. So it's the complete constituent mixture in that drink that you'll see of kava that gives you the effects. So basically, when I was at this crossroads point, I got in touch with this person. They got in touch with one of their farmers in the South Pacific. The farmer sent me a bag of the kava, gave me instructions of how to prepare it. I did. It was a very tedious process. You know, I had to go through and it took like 30 minutes, 45 minutes and squeeze it out through this strainer bag and got my strainer all gunky. And what I ended up with was like a bowl of what looked like muddy water. And let me tell you, it tasted like it too, right? So that is
kind of a numbing feeling when
yes, you're exactly.
It, right?
Exactly. And that, but those were the two problems with, you know, kava, just traditional kava, is the taste and the preparation, right? Because in order to get that, you either in the past have had to either take a solvent extract with none of the effects, or you had to prepare it yourself and drink the stuff that's hard for some people to tolerate. You know, for me, I was happy to have it, but I started drinking the stuff. I didn't care about taste, right? In my situation, I started drinking it. Within a week, there's a cumulative effect to kava, a crescendo and cumulative effect because of what we know now, the GABA receptor upregulation and some of the other different things that occur. It leads to this you know, cumulative effect that it's like a reverse tolerance because of the upregulation. So the longer you drink kava, the more you'll feel it. The least you'll ever feel kava is the first time you take it, which is opposite of the pharmaceutical, that downregulates to the upregulates, depletes, it doesn't, you know, replete. So whenever I first started taking it, after about a week, I was blown away by the effects. I was like, oh my gosh, I love this stuff. Within 3 weeks to 4 weeks, I was already reducing my dosage of benzos. Long story short, within 2 months, I was able to completely get off my benzos that I had been on for years, which is completely unheard of. Like with benzos, yeah, you have to do an extremely slow taper over usually 6 months minimum, most of the time a year, sometimes a year and a half. And sometimes you aren't even successful then, depending on how wrecked your nervous system is, how bad it is at readapting. So it was, you know, to say the least, this was a miracle for me because it literally saved my life. Because so after 2 months of taking this stuff, I was able to sustain myself. I was off of my benzodiazepines and I was able to, and they were actually more effective than the benzo was for me at reducing my reactions and seizures. It reduced all my seizure activity by like 85 to 90%. And eventually they went away within a short period of time after that. And I was able to tolerate foods again, supplements again. I was able to tolerate these treatments and therapies and my nervous system would just stay stable. And so it wasn't how I got my life back was not any one thing. It wasn't just kava. It was a multi-therapeutic approach of a bunch of things that worked in synergy together. It was the dietary framework. It was the fasting, the intermittent fasting, and then treatments and therapies that I did as the icing on the cake. I went and did stem cells multiple times in Mexico and in Panama, and I've been all over. And I got into this world because my doctor friend brought me into this world afterwards. I started doing product development and a whole bunch of other stuff, doing research for his books and other people in the field and some different things and working with you know, some of the stem cell development products and stuff. But, you know, basically from then on that, you know, kava was the leverage point that I needed to, you know, get a foothold over my sort of inhibitory reactions that were inhibiting me from being able to tolerate the things I needed to get well. And that's, you know, even if that's an extreme story with an extreme example, but in today's world, so many people Yeah, obviously stress is the underpinning of all disease. No matter what kind of stress is, physical, chemical, or emotional, it drives the irritation, drives the disease. But whenever we're overwhelmed by stress, stress can be very paralyzing, right? I mean, it can really, really paralyze people. And sometimes it's hard for people to even have the motivation to even formulate a strategy to get out of their circumstance because they're so overwhelmed that they need it. So kava is what I think of. It's a biological compatible. It's a plant medicine that is not only a safe crutch, but it also helps in the rehabilitation process. But it really comes in and it gives you acute relief from symptoms to allow you to take a breath, to allow you to get better sleep, tremendously enhances deep sleep. And that's one thing that also improved tremendously on me, which accelerated my process as well too. It's just one of those amazing sort of plant aid sort of crutches that's sort of like a guilt-free crutch, right? It's this drug alternative, this amazing thing that you can use to gain leverage psychologically, emotionally, and physically, because that's another thing that it does too. It just uplifted my emotions and it has this amazing non-addictive effect on dopamine, which helps the person get sort of, you know, focused and motivated and as well too, and just inspired, because I noticed pretty quickly, and I was in tune with this kind of stuff because I had previous psychedelic experiences. I noticed the effect that it was having on my psyche as I was taking it too, which was just a plus on top of everything else. I took it to stop my seizures and all this stuff, but I realized that I was more introspective whenever I was on high doses of it, that I was more creative. And the indigenous people have written about this for hundreds of years, thousands of years. If in Vanuatu, still to this day, in the village, they have a chief in the village, obviously, in every village. And if there's a dispute in the village, the people involved in the dispute are forced to, you know, sit down and settle it over kava. Because kava is an empathogen. It increases feelings of empathy and understanding and focus and allows you to sort of connect to people and to put yourself in their shoes and reflect on your own response to their response. It just makes you more connected. It brings people together in a really amazing way, like entheogens do. But it's one of those things that almost anybody can tolerate on a regular basis, unlike like a psilocybin where you just take it once every once in a while, and then you try to integrate the lessons that you get. Kava is one of those intermediary things that some people now are using, like in between their powerful, like, you know, ayahuasca journeys, to help kind of remind them and bring them back to that space without having to go fully there, or to sort of integrate, to keep them connected during the integration process of their lessons as well too. But it is a great conversationalist. This is why there are kava bars popping up in different places around the world. And in the islands, there are 20 times as many kava bars as there are regular bars, because the environment that kava creates is such a social, connected, loving environment, which is really the opposite of alcohol in a lot of ways, right? Mm-hmm. You'll never see a fight break out at a kava bar ever. You know, you're like that enhanced sober, right? Like, in, you know, it takes higher doses of kava to feel this, obviously. With the more subtle products, it's more like a daily tonic that even kids can tolerate. But the stronger and stronger, there are forms of kava that can get you this like more sort of entheogenic thing where you're just focused, and it's great for reflecting, connecting, brainstorming. A lot of people now, you know, today we're starting to, you know, use it in all of our brainstorming sessions. It's one of the best things that we use in our company meetings, right? It's just like, it is an amazing plant-based tool across the board. It gave me leverage, and over, you know, a number of years after that worst point that I just touched on, about 3 or 4 years later, I had my life virtually completely back, right? And it just led to this, and it sort of enhanced this already synchronistic process. So I call it the synchronicity turbine, right? That was going on in my life where, you know, you get aligned, or, you know, you get connected with an authentic part of yourself, your existential core, either through extreme pressure, adversity. And, you know, for me, it was a combination of enhancement of consciousness through previous experiences with plant medicine, and then extreme pressure and adversity that only necessity can bring out of you, that sort of most authentic part of yourself, and can sort of, you know, make you understand the value of your life and align you with a sense of meaning and purpose, and then really give you the motivation, just the relentless motivation to go after it. But yeah, so it was a combination of all of those different things that sort of led me into this world. And
so let me ask you to be mindful over time and stuff. I want to go through a couple of quick questions that you can kind of identify for people that might have, you know, there's obviously your story is incredible and there's these huge benefits that can be taken from kava. But of course, you kind of illustrated before, there's a lot of things that aren't really kava. What makes the kava that you advocate with Tru Kava, what makes it different from say other types, forms? What's so unique? Because you have an array of kava products as well.
Yes.
So can you break that down for us? What's the forms that make it work? What are the misconceptions about kava and how do they get, you know, the right product?
Yeah, exactly. So the main points and how what led to the inception of this company was me going through that entire process, getting pulled into this world, and then seeing a huge need for this in the marketplace that just was not being filled at all, right? Like this did not, like the stuff I was drinking was not in the marketplace at all, maybe in a few kava bars. But what I noticed is that even where people could buy bags of kava and prepare it themselves, there was a huge variation of quality and lack of standardized consistency because of the way kava is sourced in the South Pacific, because you know, most of the large scale kava suppliers and brokers, there's only like five of them in Vanuatu that supply most of the world's kava, which now we are, you know, the main one. But at the time, they would get, you know, bushels of kava from hundreds of different farmers that would just give it to them in bushels. They had no way of distinguishing individual strains. They had no way of distinguishing, you know, whether or not there were the right parts of the plant in there. They had no way of distinguishing a lot of these things. So here are the main factors that you want to look for. So we decided to start this company to provide, you know, to the market, basically a new commodity, which is kava in its true form, that is standardized, that is lab tested, that uses the correct parts of the plant, that's, you know, that's completely in alignment with not only the WHO's position, but also just the position, the consensus of the scientific and ethnobotanical community as to the standardized sort of biochemical framework of the plant. And I'll tell you what that means. So there are a few things that make kava really effective. Obviously, what I touched on before, not using solvent extraction. So traditional preparation is the first one. That one, we had to develop extraction methods that pulled out the full matrix that I talked about, the full constituent mixture out of the plant without damaging it, and stabilized it so that it would stay powerful, prominent, alive, living, everything like that. And obviously we wanted to put it in forms where we got rid of some of the mucky taste that the mass market wouldn't be so savvy to. Us biohackers, we don't care. We eat anything, but you know, the mainstream marketplace was not necessarily ready for that muddy water I was drinking. So I developed, you know, several extraction methods with, you know, some engineers and some, you know, some people in the industry over years. We developed a special press, a pressing method that's not a traditional expeller press, that's a hydraulic press that presses the lactone matrix out of the plant without any grinding or twisting, that pulls oxygen down into it and oxidizes, right? And we exert all of our oils that we make out of this. We make a kava oil called Kavaplex, and it's a full spectrum kava oil. We test it, and we test the starting material for all of the major kava lactones, and we do a chemotype analysis, which gives us the ratio of the lactones. So we get to know whether or not it's been denatured when we test on the other side. We also, you know, subject it to lipid peroxidation testing to see if there's been any oxidation of the oils and stuff, obviously, that we're pressing it with. So everything is pristine. We dialed it in. We have this amazing oil that we've produced called the Kavaplex oil, and it's a full spectrum kava oil. So it's the full essence of the plant that's captured in a ready to take product that is far more palatable than the traditional drink is. That's the base oil. We still did that in a concentration that can be tolerated by any age, right? It's not like the, you know, the heaviest form of kava. It's the part that's it's in a form that's still subtle but effective. If you mix it with coffee and MCT, it increases the uptake and you get more of that prominent effect faster. It's a great sort of, you know, synergy with coffee and MCT as well.
That's the oil. That's the oil that you're using.
Yes. Yeah. The oil and the other forms, but the oil goes great in the coffee and stuff.
So,
and you know, the MCT helps transport across the brain, helps with the bioavailability, all that stuff. So that's the oil. We also developed multiple different stabilized drinks. We have a shot currently. We have a whole line of drinks that are in development. The shot is stronger than the oil, so it's for more sort of acute-like situations, but it's still in a very controlled concentration to where you can take it virtually any time of the day under any circumstances. The drinks that are coming up are going to be more powerful. Those are going to be ones that can act as very adequate alcohol alternatives that are like the full strength of like what you'd get at a kava bar, but in a very, very flavorful carbonated drinks. That process was very difficult to do over many years. I mean, we spent a long time with filtering processes, with stabilizing processes, et cetera. You know, ways of increasing bioavailability and keeping everything there, you know, the way that it needed to be. So right now, the two products that we have are the oil and the Elevate Kava shots. And those are, you know, those are two, those will still deliver all of the effects of kava just in different forms there. Okay, so we have the extraction methods. The thing that we also did with ours was proper selection of the kava material. Okay, so I spent years and years before just starting a company, I spent years developing relationships in the islands, you know, getting to know everybody in the ethnobotanical community, the doctors, the researchers, the scientists, you know, everybody in, you know, a lot of people in governments that had been involved in regulatory processes around kava. I collaborated with everybody because for me, the main objective was to bring value to people. And if we're going to bring kava into the market, we had to do it right. So basically, sourcing the material meant we needed to be growing our own kava or partnering with farms that do. So basically we do. We've got, you know, farms, you know, spanning across the South Pacific in Hawaii, Fiji, Vanuatu, Tonga, Papua New Guinea, that we either partner with or we start ourselves, that we grow individual strains of kava. So that's very important. Just like cannabis, there are over 200 so different strains of kava. Some are more daytime, some are more nighttime. They all have a similar wheelhouse of effects, but some are more on the nootropic side, the kind of are more of that effect, and some are the heavier sort of sleep-inducing ones. They all lead to a good sleep. If you take it during the day, it enhances sleep at night, but some will knock you out, some won't. Okay, so we've got different strains there for that reason. The strains that we chose for our first two products, just to keep it simple, was a strain that was in the middle that's not going to knock you out. It'll lead to a good sleep, but it gives you all the balanced effects, anxiolytic effects of kava kind of in the middle there. It's a strain called Baragu, and it's a very specific strain. All the other kava in the market, there's virtually nothing out there where they're using individual strains because of what I mentioned before about the bushels coming in and them just all being mixed. You never know what you're getting, and you never know the quality of the strains. We make sure that all of our strains of kava are grown for a minimum of 5 years. That's how they mature to a level where you actually get the effects. A lot of these strains are being harvested early so they can increase their yields. Contamination is also an issue. Mycotoxins are a huge issue in places like Vanuatu because they don't, a lot of these farmers, they don't fully dehydrate their kava before they send it in because they want to increase the weight. And it's just, it's a tropical plant. So mold grows and mycotoxins, et cetera. In other islands like Fiji, they use a lot of glyphosate. They use a lot of chemical pesticides. We don't, we control every step of that process. We irrigate everything. And so there's no bacteria, there's no E. coli, there's none of this stuff. Everything is tested for biological and industrial contaminants. So it's very clean. It's the cleanest kava. It's amazing stuff. So you have, you know, the extraction method, you've got the strain selection. In the strain selection too, we only use a class of cultivars that are called, in this classification term, that's, you know, this category called noble kava. Noble kava is a classic, it's a classification term that's given to kava that are specific strains that have a certain chemotype, like I mentioned before, a certain ratio of active constituents, and none of these plant defense compounds that are in some of the more wild strains, which end up in a lot of kava products that are out there. But anyways, it's a class of kava that has been used for daily use over years and years, over generations time, you know, for 3,000 years. Other strains of kava can be acutely medicinal, but this whole idea that we hear about there on the internet of people saying that kava is toxic to the liver, that was a quality control issue that started, it was, you know, basically one pharmaceutical company in Germany and in Switzerland did a series of study with some unscrupulous material where they used the wrong parts of the plant and the wrong strains. And then they extracted it with acetone, so solvent, and they concentrated the plant defense toxins that were in there. And then they gave it to a combination of people that were withdrawing from alcohol that already had compromised liver function. They heard a few people, it got highly publicized. What they were using was not kava at all. So it's just like what happened with tryptophan in the early 1990s here. It's like, that wasn't tryptophan, this was not kava. So that's still a belief system out there. So we're doing a lot of education on that front on distinguishing real kava from not kava. So the so on top of the biological industrial contaminants, on top of the solvent extraction, the strain selection, the last thing that we have is making sure that we use 100% root material, right? Because like in that Germany-Switzerland thing, the only parts of the plant that are supposed to be used are the roots. Indigenous people figured out the leaves and stems are pretty actually toxic to humans and animals because they have plant defense alkaloids in them that are meant to protect themselves from pests. The roots do not have those. So you get the underground parts of the plant and the root is only the medicine. The leaves and stems still have kava lactones in them, so you get effects. So some unscrupulous farmers will sneak pieces of the roots in that to obviously get a greater yield out of their harvest. That's a huge problem. We test to make sure, with our farms we know, but the ones that we're sourcing from, we test for chlorophyll to make sure. So we test for all of these things rigorously. Whenever it gets in the United States, we test our material before and after extraction to make sure that it's completely full spectrum. And then we put it in some of these forms. So those are the main quality control issues at which we're meticulously looking at every step of the process. We develop the extraction processes. We have our own sourcing. Everything is as clean as it possibly can be. And what we get is we get a standardized product that you can rely on the effects, time after time, that we can create at scale. So
beautiful. Beautiful. That's a pretty example. So someone who wants to find out more, get access to Tru Kava products, how they would go, I'm sure you have a lot of information and resources and people can find out more about this, because I think a lot of people don't really understand what kava can do. And I think your story really illustrates its potency and its power. And it's the passion. I love the passion. Talk about where people can find Tru Kava, where they can experiment with Tru Kava, and and the vast array of products that you provide for people.
Yeah. So you can go to our website. It's gettrukava.com. That's get T-R-U Kava, not T-R-U-E. Get T-R-U-Kava.com. We've got most of the studies there on that website. There are more on top of that that you can email in and I'll provide to you. Our team will provide to you anything that you want to know about kava and any of the literature that's on kava, et cetera. On the, under the learn tab, you have, we have a whole page there with basically breaking down everything, all of its applications, even the applications that we didn't have time to touch on today. Like one of the main ones is kava's effect on cellular autophagy and increased fat burning. We know that now, and that's something that's really exciting because it's a great keto adaptive agent on top of everything else. So it's one of our all-stars with MCT and coffee. We talked a little bit on, I was on an interview with Dave Asprey recently. And we talked about some of that stuff. But anyway, so we've got all that information on the website. And so you can go on there and you can use, I was going to make a code for you guys. We can make, a discount code for like 15% off. We could do Bioptimizers or we could do Wade 15 or, we could do either one of those. So we'll get a code for you.
We'll put those links into that as well as the links to the effects that, you were talking about with Dave Asprey. I think that's a very interesting point. And so Dave's a good friend of ours and we've done lots of stuff. So we'll connect into that so people can get access to that as well.
Yeah. There's a whole host of them on the website. There's so many applications that just like cannabis, it's multi-therapeutic across the board, neuroprotective effects, anti-inflammatory effects, et cetera. It's just, sleep enhancing, the fat burning stuff. It's really, really interesting. So anyone who is interested can go to our website and they can look at all that stuff. You can email in for any of the studies that are not on there. And of course you can try the product. We'll give you the discount code in the description there. And up in the near future, hopefully sometime first quarter here, we'll have our drink line out. Hopefully we're, planning on at some of these conferences like Upgrade Labs and some other ones, we are going to be, catering and serving all of our drinks. We'll see if that happens depending on the state of the world. If conferences happen, But yeah, so, you know, look for all that stuff next quarter, and we're going to have several other products in the future, more products, you know, with individual strains for the medical space, for the recreational space, and just for the standard sort of mainstream market as well too. So.
Beautiful. I'm, you know, it's always so fascinating when I interview the founders of companies. And I think it was Tim Ferriss that said one time, it's, you know, the best companies are created by the people that need to scratch their own itch. They seem to, you know, and obviously you had more than a niche. It was a life-threatening condition. And the remarkable aspect is, you know, no one would ever guess that right now in an interview, that you've been able to find something that was used and now sharing that with the world. And that's a beautiful thing. And I want to commend you on the effort in order to do that. I know it's not easy to build a company. I know it's the level that you've gone to with Tru Kava. I really love the products that you've sent to me, and I'm encouraging my listeners, you know, hey, look, there are real answers to real serious challenges. And if you know someone that maybe had some of the conditions that you were talking about, or just want to have a unique experience with Kava or a legitimate experience with Kava, you can trust that Tru Kava is going to provide that for you. So be sure to check this product out, give it a shot, try it out, go to the website, get the research, check out the correlated stats and information with the fat burning effects with Dave Asprey. And what can I tell you? Cameron George, thank you so much for being on here. It's been so great to listen to your story, to learn about this, about Kava, and to use your products. I really love them. Thanks for sending them out to me. I think they're great. And for our listeners, I hope that you'll enjoy them too. That's another episode of the Awesome Health Podcast. See you again in the very near future. But until then, make sure that you stay biologically optimized, because you're worth it. Thanks so much. Take care.
And now for a Bioptimizers fixed digestion tip: how to get away with eating sugar. Hey, look, sugar is normally one of the worst things for you. But let's be honest. I mean, we all cheat from time to time. And here's a little trick that will ensure your body benefits from the sugar. Now, before you eat or drink anything sweet, take 5 to 8 capsules of P3OM. The patented strain in the formula devours sugar so fast, it literally doubles in the body every 20 minutes in the presence of sugar. That doesn't mean that you can or you should eat a bunch of sugar or sit around all day doing that. But on the days that you do cheat, or you go after one of those maybe meals that you wouldn't normally do, this ensures that you get something in your gut that eats the sugar. And it's not going to feed the bad guys or spike your blood glucose nearly as much. So to learn more about P3OM and its sugar-devouring and protein-digesting properties and how it can transform your gut and metabolism, go to www.bioptimizers.com.
Thank you for listening to the Bioptimizers Awesome Health Podcast. You can find more information at bioptimizers.com.